a place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide, where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, at the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you, I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe all to you, I owe all to you, Jesus. There's a place where sin and shame are powerless, where my heart has peace with God and forgiveness, where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, at the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you, I'm in
Amen. Praise the Lord. Lord, we thank you and we praise you and we give you all the glory, Lord, for who knew? Who knew we would make it through last year? But you did. And you carried us and you encouraged us and you have led us through with a vision, carrying us into this new year, Lord God. And so, Lord God, we don't know all that you're prepared to do in this year yet, but we know you're prepared. And so, Lord God, we're preparing our hearts. We're preparing our minds. We're preparing our bodies, Lord, that we will be fully present and prepared, Lord, to do all that you desire of us for your glory and your purpose. So we pray in this hour, Lord God, we will glorify your name and that you will be blessed, that you will be pleased, Lord God, by our offering to you. For this, Lord, we give you thanks. We give you praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. Okay, announcements. Quarter tube, our quarter tube collections support missions near and far. We will be collecting quarters to fill the tube during our announcements. Thank you, Dominic. We can always depend on you.
Amen.
Join us today at 1 p.m. for a call to pray for rain on the Dunkel Park baseball diamond. I imagine it'll be at least on the grass.
So we did update that. I thought the update got in there. We're going to do it here in the social hall, or maybe the choir room, or maybe the sanctuary. But after we have a time of fellowship, we will gather. We will be intentional to praise God because we prayed for rain, and he has brought the rain. And so we want to praise him and be intentional about that, as well as continue in praying that this rain will sustain through the year and truly, truly replenish that which has been diminished. Amen? So everyone's invited to stay afterwards and join us with prayer. We'll be doing it in the building today.
Okay, so not on the diamond where it's muddy. So, okay, on Friday, January 13th at 7 p.m., we will be hosting our first Monday movie night of the year. We will be showing the family The Chronicles of Narnia, The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe in the Education Building, a wonderful adventure. Skipping down, we will be hosting brunch at the Senior Center on Friday, January 20th. You are invited to join with us as you are willing and able. See Susan or Stacy if you have any questions. Come to worship on Sunday, January 22nd at 10:30 a.m. and stand in unity as we celebrate National Sanctity of Human Life Day. Come on Saturday, January 21st at 1 p.m. to 3 p.m. on Sunday. Sundays, January 22nd from 12 to 2 p.m. to tour off a PHC Mobile Clinic. To your bulletin for your information. I don't know what that is, Pastor.
As many know, Joy works for a pregnancy center in Merced, and her position is in the mobile clinic, where she goes out to different locations, different cities each week to serve women who otherwise would not receive pregnancy care. And so, as you know, they've been working on that van. They have new equipment. They have a new wrap. And she's going to be bringing it for us on Sanctity of Life Sunday and Saturday before, so we can tour it with the hope that in the future we'll be able to bring it here to serve and to minister to the people in our community.
So this will just be a see what it is.
See what it is.
There will not be actual care this time.
Correct.
Okay.
Unless someone pregnant would want to come.
Okay.
Then you can talk to Joy directly.
Okay, very good. Okay. Our core discipleship classes will be starting soon. Core discipleship classes form us in our faith and equip us to be the body of Christ in the world. Our Core 1 class, Living a Devoted Life, will be on Sundays at 7 p.m. from January 29th through March 12th. We will be utilizing Wick Warren's Purpose-Driven Life for this study. Upcoming meetings, our church council is meeting on Tuesday, January 10th at 7 p.m. Jana will not be there, obviously, so somebody will have to take notes. And the Christian Education and Discipleship team is meeting on Sunday, January 22nd, following worship. All meetings are held in the Education Building. Celebrants for the month of January, praise the Lord. Pam Shoemake on the 2nd, Knox Britton the 5th, Brent Lake 7th, Deanne Crockett. Wow, there's a lot of them. Praise all the birthdays. And then anniversaries, Annette and Bill Percy, Micah Rolinda Ledford, and Dwight and Linda McCraw.
I think those are worth celebrating. What do you think?
I think so.
You have all the names in your bulletin, so you can refer to them as we sing praises for God's good gift in them and through them. Amen?
Amen.
Let's sing. Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
Those anniversaries.
Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary, God bless you. Happy anniversary to you.
Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen and amen. Okay, and now I will invite you to stand and sing as we worship our Lord, our God, singing 4,000 tongues to sing.
Of his grace. sing my great Redeemer's praise. The glories of my God and King, the triumphs of His grace.
And I'm looking around to see if I see any little ones. Do I see any little ones today? I'm not finding any. Okay, Susan's going to get a break this morning, unless somebody shows up. We'll see. Would you join with me in prayer? Lord, we thank you and we praise you because you are a God who has made yourself known to us, a God we can know intimately and personally, Lord. And so, Lord, we trust you and we have confidence in you, Lord, that we can come before you, before your throne, before your presence, seeking your grace and your mercy in our lives, Lord God, as you encourage us and build us up for your purpose and for your kingdom. And so I invite you who are here today to lift up your prayers, your joys, and your concerns to our Lord, our God. Do you have any joys and concerns you'd like to lift up this day?
Okay, so a Tyler update. Many of you know that Jana had a kidney transplant about 2.5 years ago, and what triggered her transplant was this polycystic kidney disease, and unfortunately both of our kids have the same disease. Excuse me. So anyway, they both found out about 10 years ago. They both have had blood in the urine issues. So with that said, I'm good right now, but I will need it later. So about 5 months ago, Tyler caught COVID, and he started getting these coughing fits. And the coughing fits were so violent that he started vomiting so bad that he actually pulled a groin muscle and couldn't even walk to the bathroom to get sick. So anyway, he calls me in tears, afraid of losing his business, almost afraid of dying even. He was so scared. So he got a little bit better. That was in October. He got a little bit better. Then in December, he slipped on ice and fell and had blood in the urine again, which he didn't think a lot about because Jana's had that, Allie's had that, he's had that in the past, so it wasn't super worrisome for him at the time. And then a week later, he fell about the third or fourth of December, and then that weekend later, he started having these horrific pains in his body, and so he went and checked into emergency. And they found on that Sunday night, they found that he had not only broken a cyst on the inside, he had broken a cyst on the outside of the kidney. So he had all this blood in his belly, in the cavities, and as well as the blood in the urine. And he got so big, he looked 9 months pregnant. I mean, he was huge, it was hard. It was so bad that I started fearing for his life. On that Thursday, he was in such excruciating pain that he couldn't even roll in his bed to help the nurses change his bed, to roll for them to take x-rays. So they went and did another CT scan, and they thought they saw that he had no more bleeding and that we were just going to ride this out. And he did get better. They finally stopped him from vomiting in the hospital with the tube down his throat. So he got better, and he got out Tuesday before Christmas. And he went home, and he basically camped on the couch, still peeing blood. And they thought, well, since the CT scan showed that he wasn't having any more bleeding, that he just had to ride out the fact that you have blood clots in the kidneys, and those blood clots are flowing out and whatever. And that was the diagnosis as he left the hospital. And he felt better, but he has zero energy. Sleeps on the couch, taking a shower, he would take a shower and come back and sleep for 2 hours. So for 2 weeks, he did some blood tests, and then 2 weeks later, last Wednesday, he went and saw the VA doctor, actually a physician's assistant, and he got sick in front of the VA doctor. They took more blood tests and basically went home. But we're encouraged from the fact that at least somebody's seeing him that he's getting sick in front of, instead of this mantra, well, he'll be fine and he'll ride this out and this will be get better. On Thursday, they call and said he needs to get to emergency ASAP because he was 2 pints of blood short. And so he got two pints of blood on Thursday, as well as saline solutions and another CT scan that actually showed that one of the kidneys is still leaking blood from the inside, which is what's causing his low blood count. And, you know, the concern is that it'll continue. How long do they wait? So he went and did that. He is a very sick boy. The good part is I believe everything is fixable. He just has to ride the course. He has to wait another 2 weeks before he can even see a nephrologist. Jana has done the research to download all the information from the hospital so that she can give it to, she found that UCSF for a fee will actually do a second opinion. The problem is he has not seen a nephrologist for a first opinion. So, and he's on the waiting list for another to 23rd of January, and they're hoping for an update on that. So, we will see. He's still super weak. It was a very great thing that he got up and got to the fridge to get his own breakfast and then sat down and laid down. That was like an accomplishment. That's how weak he is. He's still very weak. He still gets sick several times a day. He does have a urologist that seems to have taken care with, you know, concern with him. The problem is the urologist doesn't have really the authority on the kidneys. But the CT scans were showing that his kidneys were so enlarged that it's pushing everything around inside of him, which is causing constrictions on the diaphragm, constrictions on the throat. Any little thing is now triggering a coughing, and he really hasn't stopped coughing, and he hasn't really stopped getting sick either. And so Jan is up there now, and she will probably be there at least until he talks to a nephrologist to move forward doing research. There is things they can do for him. It's just getting people off their derriere to see him and get it moving. But we have, at least he's seen some people now that have seen how sick he is. So we will see. We will see. Unfortunately, we were hoping that she could see, convince her current surgeon that did her kidney transplant to see him or at least see his information, but we're going to have to go through UCSF because Stanford doesn't take VA, and she is now, since she's so far along away from seeing her doctor, she can't access him directly. She'll see him in August, and that's the only time she'll have a chance to contact him. So anyway, keep praying for him. He's got a really long road in front of him. Thank you.
Lord God, we thank you for the life of Tyler, for he is a good gift from you to his family, to his friends, to this world. And Lord, you know all that he's going through. You know much better than we do. And so, Lord, we've been praying for this man, and we continue to lift him up in the name of our risen Savior, Jesus our Christ. Lord God, that you would bring him comfort in his body, in his mind, and in his spirit, Lord God. That you would give his body rest, his lungs rest, Lord God, so that they could heal, so his body can heal. Bring him into stillness, Lord God, your stillness, your grace, your mercy, and bring healing upon him like only you can, Lord.
We trust him to the doctors, Lord, and all those attending to him. And Lord, we pray you make the way that any hurdles or obstacles that are in the way slowing down his process, Lord, we pray you clear that through your mercy and through your grace. And Lord, as we lift up Tyler to you, we lift up Doug and Jana, we lift up Marlene, his siblings, Lord God, and all those who love him. Be with them, Lord. Let each of them be part of the healing process in his life as you are bringing healing into all of their lives. For this we give you thanks, and for this we give you praise. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
Another hurdle that he has is he is O negative, which is the blood, and there's only 7% of the population is O negative, and O negative can only receive O negatives from my research. And also researching transplants, we're just trying to get him comfortable so that he could live until he needs a transplant. But the transplant for an O negative person is, they say a regular transplant list is like 5 years, and O negative transplant list is 7 years. So another hurdle for him to have to deal with. And I would give one mine, but I don't think my kidneys are strong enough. So that's the way it goes. Thank you.
I want to lift up the Lake family. They're not here today because they had a difficult morning. So just keep them in your prayers in the season that they're in, Carol being a caregiver and Rod being the one who's cared for. Lord, we commit them to your loving care. Other prayers and concerns you'd like to lift up this morning?
First, having come after that, I believe it's not an accident that I am a dialysis nurse to understand what's all happening. And I've seen my patients, you know, as they go through their own sorrows and difficulty. But my praise there, as I have talked to Doug actually before they found out it's really related to the kidney, my praise is that now they know what's the root cause. And for us in the medical field, once there is a diagnosis, that's 50% of the game. The rest of the 50% is going through the process of how the medical system really addressed the issue. So that's going to be a long haul of prayer for us supporting Doug. But my hope is that they know now what's going on. And so they're going to really, and we pray indeed that it's going to be hastened, because I have seen medical service go slow. But there's nothing hard for God. There's nothing impossible. And, you know, we've been praying for Mark. Anyway, so that's just what I wanted to say. And I will really pray. And I understand the picture and all of that. And I don't know if I'm O negative because I'm type O. So I don't know. I don't know. And even the provision of a kidney is a miracle, too. I've seen our patients receive kidneys, and that's just amazing how God makes it happen. So anyway, my prayer is that Jod is on her way back home. So the last update is that they're on their way to the airport, and tomorrow we'll have her home. So I'm off tomorrow because I'm going to see her soon. So that's a praise. And my prayer is really about the Sanctity of Human Life Sunday, which we will celebrate as a church for the first time. It always happens on January, and I am so thankful that Pastor is willing to celebrate it, and that I am really excited to bring the van over. And I talked to my boss already, and the only thing that's kind of like making my boss kind of, you know, apprehensive, but she already agreed to bring the van here overnight, even for 2 days. Usually when we have the van for a tour, it's just 1 day. We are looking for a garage that is secured because we want the van parked overnight in a secure, because we are afraid of the vandalism and the activism that might happen in attack of our ministry. And so the van is always a high risk. So we just wanted to find a place where we can park it securely, because I even offered our garage, which is a covered, because that's what they initially wanted, a covered garage, but it won't fit. It won't fit in our garage because of the length and the height. So that's one thing, and I hope we can, even if it's not covered, as long as it's secured with gated and that the van can park overnight so that we can have it for 2 days. All right, that's my prayer.
Amen. So if you have provision, please let us know. Other prayers.
In the same vein of what Doug is, but not nearly as serious at this point, Mark has been put on a transplant list. So now we just pray that some lungs come up that are healthy that he can utilize. So pray for that, please.
In Jesus' name, other prayers.
I want to pray for Daniel. His birthday is tomorrow. And I pray that God gives him peace, good health, happiness, and many more years. I want to pray for all the people that are going to be suffering since Madera Hospital is going to be closing. It's a devastating thing for the community and the surrounding communities, especially for the people that have relied on those doctors for many years. I know my dad is going to be now looking for a new doctor. So please pray for me so that I can have the strength and do whatever I have to do to find a good doctor for my dad, because he's dependent on his medications and constant need of seeing a doctor, and that we find out what's going on, because I know sometimes he has a bad day, and if you see him, you wouldn't even be able to tell anything, because he's always such a strong man with a smile on his face, and he's fine. But as his daughter, it worries. So I pray that that I'm able to do that, to find insurance for him. You know, that's one of the biggest things that holds me back. But prayers for all the people that are looking for a doctor, and that maybe American Ambulance can help carry those people that need emergency services to Fresno or to any other hospital needed in time. And that's it.
Amen, Lord. We commit this family to you, to your mercy and your grace, Lord. Provide the way for them. And, Lord, not just any doctor, but a doctor who will know him and love his life as much as you do. In Jesus' name we pray. Other prayers.
Can we keep Uncle Noah in prayer? He fell and... He's been having a hard time ever since he felt he can't sleep on his right side. And can we keep my Uncle Carl in prayer for his safe travels with my aunt?
Amen and amen.
I have a quick testimony. Is that okay, Pastor? So I want to thank the Lord. Very grateful to the Lord. I was going through some stuff, and... I was able to come to church here on Wednesday, and just spend some time with the Lord, praying, even crying, and I felt like a burden come off me, but I still needed to hear something from the Lord regarding the circumstance that I was going through. I quickly went to the smock shop in Mendota, and while I was there, I saw a Nigerian man who was also waiting, and I felt that I needed to talk to him, And as I started talking to him, he let me know that he was stuck there because his car was not going to be fixed today or that day, and that he was stressing how he was going to get home to Clovis. I felt like I had to offer him the ride to Clovis. I took him. The man ended up being a Muslim who became a born-again Christian 14 years ago, and on the way back to Clovis, he was just really blessing me with the words, and finally gave me the word that I felt I needed to hear regarding my circumstances. So I hope this encourages you, everybody here. If you're going through a circumstance, God is greater than your circumstance. We have to have faith and pray and believe and do whatever God indicates us to do.
Praise the Lord. Amen.
The week of Christmas, we were blessed that me, David, and Abraham all didn't have school, and we got the week off of work to go see my family in Sacramento. So we got to see my little brother, my grandparents, and my older sister for a week. It's just such a blessing to see my little brother walking again. I haven't seen him walk in over a year. So he's walking, but prayers for him, because he does have one leg longer than the other. So he has a hard time walking because he has to walk on his tippy toes, and he has consistent back pain due to his accident. So there's prayers for him.
Amen. Any other prayers?
We need to continue to pray for Ted and Deanne, especially. They have COVID, and Deanne's having a really, really hard time with this. So please, please keep her in your prayers.
Amen.
Got a phone call this morning from very good friends of ours, and their daughter's son-in-law, 41 years old, dropped dead of a heart attack last night. So they need an extra share of God's grace this morning. So just pray for that family.
What's the family name?
Vincent.
Amen. The Lord knows that this is some of the most important work we do in the church. Gathering together, praying together, keeping each other in our hearts and in our minds, and lifting each other up to our Lord, our God, that we may live the abundant life that Christ has promised to us. And we do. We thank you, Lord. And Lord, we know that none of these prayers go out in vain, Lord, but you hear everyone rising up to you as if like incense, pleasing to you, Lord God. And so, Lord God, all these prayers we've lifted up to you, all the prayers of our nation, Lord God, we submit to you, to your will, to your purpose, Lord God. To the families in this church, those who are near and those who are far, we submit them to you, Lord God. Praising you for the victories in our lives, thanking you for sustaining us in difficult times, Lord God, and trusting and relying upon you each and every day. For, Lord God, we know that in this life we cannot be victorious apart from you. So we thank you and we praise you. And so, Lord, we pray as one body in Christ Jesus, praying the way that your Son taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And I know this probably isn't the best day to do this, but I planned it and I'm going to do it anyway, just because I'm delinquent and I'm getting this done. And so as we're preparing for the all that's going on in this coming year for upcoming classes, I want to recognize those who decided last year that believing wasn't good enough, that trusting wasn't good enough, and they signed up and spent 8 weeks together learning what it means to live a spirit-filled life. So if you were part of that class, not everybody's here, but if you were part of that class, I invite you to come up now, Regina. I don't see Stacy here today unless she's in the kitchen. Stacy, if you're in the kitchen, you need to come. I don't know. Susan? Dwight and Linda? And Steve? We also had Carol Lake. We also had Cindy Bess, Stacy, Michelle Cardella, and Deanne Crockett, all who spent their time growing in knowledge and understanding of the Lord their God. You're on top, so you got to come up. You did all the work. You get all the credit. Yeah, God gets all the credit, but that's all right. Can we give a clap offering to these people? They're doing the kingdom work. I want you to remain here for just a moment. Now, if you were here on December 4th and you decided to make a decision to become a full member of our church, I have your full membership certificates with me here, and I would like to give it to you personally. So if you were here, Dominic, come on up. David, come on up. Jeremy, Kathy, and Mark, come on up. Susan is already here. We also had Deanne and Ted. We also had Amanda. And we also had Stephen and Maria. And I'm telling you, they did that on the compulsion of the Holy Spirit because that was not planned. And one more big clap offering for the Lord for all he's doing in the life of our church. Amen. Thank you all. Praise the Lord for his good gifts in you and through you. You may be seated.
Please stand for today's scripture reading if you're willing and able. Using your own Bible or a pew Bible, I invite you to turn to the Genesis 3, 1 through 8, the fall of Adam. Now the serpent was more crafty than any other beast of the field that the Lord had made. He said to the woman, "Did God actually say you shall not eat of any tree in the garden?" And the woman said to the serpent, "We may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden, but God said, 'You shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the midst of the garden. Neither shall you touch it, lest you die.' But the serpent said to the woman, 'You will not surely die, for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil.' So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate, and she also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both were open, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves loincloths. And they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees in the garden. But the Lord God called to the man and said to them, 'Where are you?' The second reading is from 1 Corinthians 15, 42 through 39, the last Adam. You are invited to stand as well. Okay, so it is with the resurrection of the dead. What is sown is perishable, what is raised is imperishable. It is sown in dishonor, it is raised in glory. It was sown in weakness, it was raised in power. It was sown in a natural body, it is raised a spiritual body. If there is a natural body, there is also a spiritual body. Thus is it written, 'The first man, Adam, became a living being. The last Adam became a life-giving spirit.' But it is not the spiritual that is first, but the natural, and then the spiritual. The first man was from earth, a man of dust. The second man of heaven. As was the man of dust, so also are those who are of the dust. And as is the man of heaven, so also are those who are of heaven. Just as we have borne the image of the man of dust, we shall also bear the image of the man of heaven." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Amen. You may be seated. Would you pray with me? Lord, you are a good, good Father, and Lord, everything you have done has been with us in mind. And so, Lord, we continue to pray that all that we do is pleasing to you. Our efforts, our desires, the deepest desires of our hearts, Lord, we pray they're pleasing to you. And so as we lean in this morning, Lord God, to understand more about who you are and who you desire us to be, we pray, Lord, we pray together. And I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts, that they will be acceptable to you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. It was on January 2nd, not January 1st, which was a bit of a surprise to me, nor was it on December 31st. It was on January 2nd when I woke up with a tremendous joy upon my heart. A tremendous joy for all that the Lord was preparing to do in the life of our church this year. Now, the Lord had not revealed to me any specific things about what he's planning to do or how he's going to do it. He simply placed this joy upon my heart, this unexplainable joy. I didn't know what it was all about, but I know from who it came. Amen. And so on December 31st, as the last year was coming to an end, and on January 1st, as our new year was beginning, there was a tremendous hope for all God will do, especially for the new direction that God has set for our church in this year. Yet I can't say that I was experiencing a specific joy or a zealousness in this hope. But on January 2nd, I woke up, and it was there, and it was undeniable. I awoke with a joy in my heart, and it has not waned. From the workings of my first sermon of the year to the workings of our first Bible study to the beginning of conversations about a new youth ministry in our church, I have been overwhelmed with hope. I have been overwhelmed with joy and the expectation of what God is going to do without knowing why. What God has in mind. Do you see? The Christmas spirit can overflow and continue into the new year. The great Christmas spirit of anticipation and expectation for what God will do. Believing and knowing in the depths of our heart that he is prepared to do something big. So the question that remains then is, are we ready for it? You've heard me say that this will be a year of sacrifice, and this is most certainly true. For us to set a new independent path apart from our current denomination, we will have to give not out of abundance, but out of scarcity. What we give for this effort will truly be a sacrifice for all the people in our church. But yet the greater sacrifice remains. How much of yourself will you give to God? Not out of abundance, but out of scarcity. For God does not rely on our strengths for his glory. He relies on our weaknesses for his glory. He relies on our trust in him and our obedience to him. And that's where it all fell apart. Now, as a pastor, I am acutely aware of the broad spectrum of knowledge and understanding of the Bible and of our faith that exists in the life of our church, in the life of all churches, really. I know that as I call upon many of our patriarchs and our matriarchs of our faith, that not everyone is always knowledgeable of the references that I am making, of who I'm referring to, or what meaning their lives and their experiences carry for us. And so this year, as we dig deeper into scriptures, into our salvation story, we will be spending time getting to know some of the other main players in our salvation story. We will be taking time to know the lives, the circumstances, the personalities of many of the biblical persons who came before us, those whom God chose to prepare us to receive his promise of salvation, to receive his son, Jesus Christ. For Jesus Christ is the cornerstone. He is the foundation of our faith, and it is the prophets and the apostles who have built upon it. And now it's our turn. Now it's our time to continue in that faith, to continue building the foundation in our community and in the world. Amen. And while this will be useful in your understanding and your knowledge of the Bible and of your faith story, I truly hope it will be. It will only become cemented within you, when you start reading that story for yourself. So if you have not done so already, I encourage you, go to our website. Go to our devotional resources page and pick a Bible reading plan for the year. and see how your relationship with God and with Christ Jesus grows as you grow in knowledge and an understanding of his word. And you don't have to be a scholar. You don't have to be an expert, because the Holy Spirit will give you understanding. You do the work, the Holy Spirit will give you the understanding. That's been my experience, and that's my promise to you. And so today we are introduced to four key persons in our salvation story. We are introduced to God, to Adam and Eve, and to Satan. Now, many of you may question whether Adam and Eve were real persons. I know many people who have. Some may believe they are an allegory which explains our good creation. In fact, many pastors teach this story in that way. But let me challenge your understanding. Let me challenge it by asking you a few simple questions. Do you believe God created the heavens and the earth and everything in them? Do you believe God created us? Do you believe God has the power to overcome death, offering us eternal life? Amen. Amen. Most every Christian I know believes and agrees to these basic tenets in our faith. Yet they struggle to believe, many do, that God, through his wisdom, is powerful enough to begin human life through one man and through one woman. Let me suggest this to you. It is through biblical wisdom that we are given this truth of our origins. It is through human wisdom that this truth is contested. So will you trust more in human wisdom or more in godly wisdom? For certainly if God can create the heavens and the earth and everything in them, including us, he could choose to do so through one man and through one woman. Just as he chose one man, John the Baptist, to prepare the way for the coming of Jesus our Christ. And isn't that the way he works? Time and time, again through scriptures, choosing the least, the weakest, choosing one. In Genesis 1:26, God says, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over all the earth." So we're left to ask, what do we learn about Adam from this verse? The first thing we learn about Adam is that God created Adam. God created us to rule with him over his good creation. Now, those who are wicked will use their own power, use this power to their own advantage, and that is self-evident. Yet God intended us to rule with justice and with righteousness, to rule in the same way that he lords over our lives. For this is the purpose of being created in his image. This is the purpose of being created in his likeness, that we will be like him. Amen? In Genesis 1:28, God says to Adam and Eve, "Be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth and subdue it." Now, once again, human wisdom falls a little bit short here. For the common teaching and understanding from this verse is that God's instructions to Adam and Eve was to procreate, to have kids and grandkids and great-grandkids, and there's truth in this. But there's a greater truth that is intended for us and for our lives and for our lives today. You see, the problem with this teaching is that in the Bible, being fruitful is equated with spiritual growth. And so what does the Bible say? What does it equate being fruitful with? Let's take a look. From Matthew 13, 23, Jesus declares, "The seed that fell on the good soil represents those who truly hear and understand God's word and produce a harvest, 30 and 60, even 100-fold, as much as had been planted." From Colossians 1, 9 and 10, "We have not ceased to pray for you, asking that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding, bearing fruit in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God." And from Romans chapter 7, verse 4, "Likewise, you also have died to the law through the body of Christ, so that you may belong to one to another, to him who has been raised from the dead, in order that you may bear fruit for God. It's not about human procreation. To be fruitful and to multiply means to increase exponentially the knowledge and understanding of God in the world, in our families, in our workplaces, in our church, in our lives. It means to disciple each other in the word of God and in the ways of God. For this is what leads to life everlasting, to an eternal life with God. Now I want you to take note that Paul intentionally states that it is through the body of Christ, through the work of Christ in the church, that we are discipled, that we come to knowledge and understanding of God, and it is through the life of the church that we come to bear fruit for God. So what else do we know about Adam? In Genesis chapter 2, verses 8 and 15, we learn how God planted a garden in Eden, and there he placed the man he had formed. It goes on to say that the Lord took the man and put him in the garden of Eden to till it and to keep it. The literal translation of this verse says to cultivate it and to keep it, meaning to watch over it carefully, to tend to it with love, to preserve it. Compare this with God's command to Adam after the fall from Genesis 3:17, in which he says, "Because you have eaten from the tree about which I commanded you, saying, 'You shall not eat of it,' cursed is the ground on account of you, and in hard labor you will eat of it all the days of your life." Do you see? When we are obedient to the ways and the desires of God, we are blessed by God even in the work we do, cultivating and tending to God's good creation, to his ultimate purpose for our salvation. But when we turn against the ways of God, when we defy his word, that is when we experience pain, that is when we experience toil, and that is when our lives will be subjected to hard labor. I speak from experience. There's a tremendous richness in the Bible when we read it slowly. When we take time to come to know the lives and the experiences of the people who came before us. And there's much more to uncover about Adam and Eve from these first two chapters of the Bible than I have time to explore today. So let's take a close look at the key elements that led up to the great fall. The first verse of the third chapter tells us that the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God has made. Now, there are two important things to pay attention to here. First, this verse describes Satan as a serpent who was subtle, meaning he's crafty, he is shrewd, and he is sensible. The devil knows that, practically speaking, all he has to do is simply introduce doubt into our minds, into our hearts, and we will begin to question the things that we already know, the things we already believe, the things we already trust. Second, while a simple understanding of this passage teaches us that Satan took control of the serpent to use it as an instrument of temptation, other scriptures affirm for us the truth in this passage. From Revelation chapter 12, verses 9 and 10, it describes the battle in heaven against Satan in this way. It says, "The great dragon was cast out, that ancient serpent who is called the devil and Satan, who deceives the world. For the accuser, that is Satan, has been cast down." Now, I want you to keep this in mind as part of your own salvation story. Satan will deceive you. You can count on that. And he will draw himself to himself. And then he will accuse you before God. Jesus revealed to us the truth, drawing us to himself. And for those who confess him before others, he says, "I will confess them before my Father who is in heaven." Who will you choose to follow? To whom will you choose to be obedient? Whose image will you bear? Okay, I'm going to try to bring this home for you as quickly as possible. There's a lot of richness in this, and I know it's already been a long morning. Satan, the ancient serpent, introduced doubt into Eve's heart and into her mind by simply questioning what God had said. He said, "Has God said to you, you shall not eat of any tree of the garden?" The question in itself is a lie because he knew better. He knew what God said. You see, Satan creates doubts about God in our hearts, in our minds, by questioning us, asking, "Do you really believe God meant what he said? Do you really believe God meant what he said? Do you really believe God meant what he gave to us through his written word?" Satan challenged Eve, and what was her response? She had been told by Adam, who was told by God, "Of every tree of the garden you may freely eat, but of the tree of knowledge of good and evil you may not eat, for in that day you will eat of it, you will surely die." When Satan spoke doubt into Eve's mind, she began to doubt that which she already knew. She began to doubt that which she already believed and that which she already trusted. And she responded saying, "We may eat of the fruit from the trees in the garden, but from the tree in the middle of the garden, God said, you will not eat of it, nor will you touch it, or else you will die." Now the good Lord never said Adam and Eve would die if they touched the fruit. Do you see? Only if they eat of it will they die. It seems like a subtle nuance, but even the slightest distortion of God's word, of his truth, can lead to the greatest evil. Even the slightest distortion of his truth can lead to eternal death. So don't let it happen in your minds. Don't let it happen in your hearts. Let the Lord Jesus protect you and cover you through his word and through personal time with him. Do you see the importance of knowing and understanding God's word for yourself and not simply believing what you've been told, what you've been heard, what you've heard, or relying on traditions? For in this way, ignorance can be catastrophic. Once again, there's much more to unveil here, but I'm running short on time, I know. But keep this in mind concerning Adam and Eve. After they disobeyed God, after they ate of the forbidden fruit, they were cut off from their source of life. They were separated from God. No longer would they enjoy a personal and an intimate relationship with their creator and with their provider. And when God came searching for them, what did they do? They ran and they hid from him. And it caused me to ponder, to wonder. When we choose not to spend time with God daily in word and prayer, I wonder, are we really trying to hide from him, from his word, from his will for our life? In our reading from Paul's first letter to the church in Corinth, which we heard this morning, Paul contrasts the life before Christ with the life after Christ. He does this by drawing a comparison between the first Adam and between Jesus Christ, between the first man and the second man, between the first Adam and the last Adam. Consider what Paul says. He says, "What is sown is perishable. What is raised is imperishable. As far as these bodies go, from dust we have been created, and to dust it shall return. But for those who have been raised in Christ, we are promised a glorified body on the day of resurrection, a physical body like Christ, which is imperishable. It is sown in dishonor, it is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, it is raised in power. It is sown a natural body. It is raised a spiritual body. Praise be to God." And in this passage, it declares the following. It says, "The first man, Adam, became a living being. The last Adam became a life-giving spirit." And what's important to know here is that the Greek language that Paul uses for the word became is two different words. He uses two different words in this verse. When speaking of Adam, Paul says the first man became Adam, or the first man, Adam, became a living being. The Greek word he uses literally means to come into being, to become. When speaking of Christ, Paul says the last Adam became a life-giving spirit. And here the Greek word he uses literally means to make alive. Literally, it means to make that which was dead to live. Yeah, that's right. And that should be our reaction. Woo! Praise the Lord. This is the good news of Jesus Christ. For you see, the last Adam is Christ. Because he rose from the dead, he is a life-giving spirit. That means he entered into a new form of existence. He was the first to receive a glorified body, a physical body in which the fullness of God chose to dwell. Jesus Christ is our source for our spiritual life, that spiritual life that results in our own resurrection from the dead. And Christ's new glorified human body now suits his new glorified life. Just as Adam's body was suited for his natural life. And this is our promise. When our bodies are resurrected, God will give us a transformed body, an eternal body like Christ, suited for a new eternal life with him. Amen? Come on, that's good news, all. So as for me, I choose to trust God at his word. That's my choice. That's my belief. And I believe it is within his will and within his power to begin life through one man, as much as I believe it is within his power to save life through one man. Amen? And so remember this. When in doubt, simply believe. When in doubt, believe simply. And in doing so, you will find the joy and the peace of Christ, which transcends all understanding. I promise you. For just as we have been born the image of the man of dust, so too shall we bear the image of the man in heaven. And for this, let us give all honor, glory, and praise to God our Father, to Jesus our Christ, and to God the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now let us take this time to lift up our offering to our Lord, our God. Lord, we thank you and we praise you for all of your promises, for all of your good gifts, for the very breath of life which we enjoy. And Lord, we thank you for these good gifts which have come from you. And so we return to you, Lord God, that which is already yours. I pray, Lord God, to bless these gifts. Bless those who have given them and bless them, Lord, for whom they are given. Use them for your glory and your kingdom. We pray all this in the mighty name of Jesus our Christ. Amen. I invite you to remain standing for our closing hymn, Waymaker. You
working in this place. I worship you. I worship you.
Never forget us. You never forsake us. You are always with us. Your love never fails. It is steadfast. It was here before we came. It is here with us now, and it will be forevermore. So we praise your holy name. We give you all the glory, and we submit all of all who we are, all of our lives to you, our Lord, our God, Jesus, our Christ, and Holy Spirit. Raise up in us, Lord God, a spirit pleasing to you. Raise up in us, Lord God, a spirit of boldness. Raise up in us, Lord God, a spirit, Lord God, which will advance your kingdom with glory and with power. You've been chosen. You've been chosen by Jesus Christ. Accept his gift to you, his gift of the Holy Spirit, and go out this day. Go out this week to love, to serve our Lord, our God. Go out this week filled with his unexplainable joy and peace in your hearts. And share that with all you know and with all you meet. Amen.